Good morning again. God is so good to us. We have much to be thankful for. But today we want to talk about something very important. One of the most important things that's mentioned in the New Testament even. And that is spiritual gifts. Now I promised to you at prayer meeting night, those of you who are listening, that we would be talking about spiritual gifts and especially focusing on the gift of prophecy. And I have to tell you, I probably am going to have to, how should we say this, not fulfill that promise quite completely. Because we're not really going to be able to focus too much on prophecy today. That will be our sermon next week. I'm sure we'll be ready to laser focus on it next week. But there's just so much here that as I got to studying and thinking about it, I felt like we really need to cover some essential points first on the basic fundamentals here. Have you ever seen the Amish people build a barn? Do you know how the Amish people build a barn? It's not one person getting in building his barn, is it? It's a group. Hundreds of Amish people will come together. Picture some Amish men on the roof of a barn. They're having a big barn raising. Hundreds of Amish men will come together from a community. And they will have usually a master designer, someone who usually does this, and he knows how to do it quite well. And he will just start directing everybody. And everybody knows their different thing that they're good at and what they do. And they're just swarming like ants over this barn. And in just a matter of a day, they will erect a whole large barn. The Jehovah's Witnesses do this too sometimes when they're building their little kingdom halls. They will have a group come in on Friday and they will work, unfortunately, through Sabbath. And by Sunday, they're usually ready to worship in that church. But they have specialties. People who are specialists. They have electricians and they have carpenters and they have plumbers and roofers and people who specialize in these things, and they all know what they're doing and they just work together in harmony, in unison. It's a nice thing to watch. Well, God has a plan for His church. And He has a plan for the work in His church, to work in specialized, united groups for the building up of His church. And to do this, He has given spiritual gifts for His work. Now, it was mentioned in Sabbath School, and I would like to just mention it here again, because I think it's a good distinction. In Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23, it speaks about the fruit of the Spirit. But we're not talking about the fruit of the Spirit here. It involves characteristics of our Christian character, development of our Christian character. But the spiritual gifts deal with the development of the church, which is the body of Christ, all of the people combined. Now, these gifts, the fruit of the Spirit or the gifts of the Spirit, either one actually, and both in this particular case, there's a prerequisite that we need to lay down very quickly before we begin, then we're going to go on past it, that I believe is important. And that's found in Acts chapter 5 and verse 32. Acts chapter 5 and verse 32. Here Peter says, "And we are his witnesses of these things, and so is also the Holy Ghost," or the Holy Spirit, "whom God hath given to them that obey him." And I'm going to tell you, friends, you're not going to get the gifts of the Spirit if you don't have the Holy Spirit to start with. Isn't that right? And you're not going to get the Holy Spirit unless you're willing to do what?
Obey
him. Obey him. That is so important. Now, there are four direct references to the term spiritual gifts or spiritual gift in the New Testament. We're going to look at all these references. We're going to read them. We're going to sort of dissect them, take them apart, look at all the different things that are involved in them. And the first place we want to go is Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1 and verse 11. "For I long to see you, that I may impart unto you some spiritual gift, to the end ye may be established. That is, that I may be comforted together with you by the mutual faith both of you and me." But here he uses this expression, spiritual gift. And he says, I want to impart a spiritual gift. Now, Paul's not saying, I'm going to give you so that you have that spiritual gift, but I'm going to use a spiritual gift that I have, and I'm going to share this blessing of it with you. And specifically, it's interesting, he speaks in verse 12 that they could be all comforted together. And we're going to find that this fits into the bigger program as we go on. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 12 now. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And there are lists of these spiritual gifts that we're going to look at in a little bit, but right now we're just looking at this expression, spiritual gifts, first. So I'm in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 1. He says, "Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant." And so this is something that Paul wants the people to understand, as has been said. Perhaps there was a controversy over these spiritual gifts in the church at Corinth, and people didn't understand their usage and whatnot. And Paul says, I don't want you to be ignorant. But of course, since the scripture is written for all of us as well, we realize that God doesn't want us to be ignorant. Now, there's a point I should just note out here. If you look in the verse, the word gifts, what is unique about the word gifts? It's a supplied word. It's a supplied word. Now, that's okay. But it happens to be a supplied word, just so you know. Let's now go to chapter 14. 1 Corinthians, chapter 14, and verse 1. He says, "Follow after charity and desire spiritual gifts, but rather that you may prophesy." He says, desire spiritual gifts, but you notice again the word gifts is what?
Italicized,
isn't it? In verse 12 of the same chapter, 1 Corinthians 14, verse 12. "Even so ye, for as much as ye are zealous of spiritual gifts," and gifts again is what? It's italicized. That's okay though. "Seek that ye may excel to the edifying of the church." And so he's here again, he brings us this concept of spiritual gifts. And then there's another text that's a little out of the way and doesn't exactly fit the exact same mold, but I want you to turn with me to Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 4. It says, "God also bearing them witness both with signs and wonders and divers miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost," or gifts of the Holy Spirit according to His own will. So we read about spiritual gifts, gifts of the Spirit, and here it speaks about the gifts of the Holy Spirit in this reference. And what we have is a little chart here. And we have these different references, Romans 1:11, 1 Corinthians 12:1, 1 Corinthians 14:1, 1 Corinthians 14:12, and Hebrews 2:4. And we have the manuscripts with the morphology and then the lemma or the definition as you would see it in the dictionary. In Romans chapter 1 and verse 11, the Greek word here for spiritual is pneumatikon. It's from the lemma pneumatikos. And you see the morphology is J-A-S-N. The J stands for an adjective. And so it is an adjective, it is in the accusative form, it is singular, and it is neuter, as all of these will be neuter. And then you have also in Romans 1:11, the Greek word for gift there is charisma, and it's from charisma. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 1, you have a very similar word here. You have pneumatikon, and it's from pneumatikos again, and this is also an adjective. In 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and verse 1, you have pneumatika. This is also from pneumatikos, and it is also, as you notice, it is an adjective as well. In 1 Corinthians 14, 12, you have pneumatikon, and it's from the lemma of just simply pneuma. And in Hebrews chapter 2:4, you have pneumatos from pneuma. And that is a noun, genitive, singular, neuter. But now in 1 Corinthians 12:1 and here in 14:1 and 14:12, we have slightly different variations of the same lemma word, except for in 14:12, where it just goes down to pneuma. But here you notice that in 1 Corinthians 12, 1 Corinthians 14, these are adjectives. They're adjectives. And so they have to have something that they're modifying. And so even though the word gift or gifts is not in the text, something has to be there. And gifts is the appropriate word. And you notice that in 1 Corinthians 12:1, 1 Corinthians 14:1, that you have a little P there. And that P stands for plural. And that's why they put in gifts and not just gift. Okay? And then also in chapter 14, verse 12, it's plural. So it should be spiritual gifts. Okay? And then in Hebrews 4:12, it's just pneuma from pneumatos. So the phrase spiritual gifts in a literal sense does not appear as such in the New Testament. We do find spiritual gift in Romans 1:11, but these texts do, by their very nature of the language, necessitate a word there. For instance, I could see, how could I express this? If someone came in here, for instance, right now with a gun, and they started to point at someone, I might look at that person and yell, "Stop!" Now, that is a complete sentence grammatically in English. Just one word, stop. But there's no subject. I thought you had to have a subject and a predicate to make a full sentence, right? But we would say that the subject is implied. It's you stop.
Understood.
It's understood. And so in the Greek, sometimes you have these different things that have to be supplied because according to language, it's understood. The Greek people had no problem understanding that these things had to be there. Again, we mentioned that gift is from the word charisma, and it goes back to the word charis, from which we get our word grace. Charisma means, and in fact, I think I have it here on our next slide. Charisma means a free gift or gift of grace, a gift graciously given or a gracious bestowment, we might say. Is that right?
That's right.
Yes, that's right. Okay. Now, in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 5 through 7, if we could go back there. 1 Corinthians 12, 5 through 7, we'll read that. And we see here that Paul employs three other terms in referring to spiritual gifts. 1 Corinthians 12, 5 through 7. And there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which worketh all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit withal. Now notice in verse 5, it speaks about differences of administrations. In verse 6, it speaks about diversities of operations. And then in verse 7, it speaks about manifestations of the Spirit. And I have a little chart here. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 5 here, we have the word diakonion, and it means ministries or the act of service. We get our word deacon from the root word this comes from. And then in the under the verse 6, we have energimaton, meaning operations, activities, or workings. It comes from the Greek word ergon, meaning work. And then in verse 7, we have the manifestations of the Spirit. Phanerosis to pneumatos, meaning manifestations of the Spirit. Now, there's also something a little different about the gift of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit as a whole as being a gift. For instance, in Acts chapter 2 and verse 38, Peter said to the people on the day of Pentecost, he said, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of your sins, and ye shall receive the gift," not gifts of the Holy Ghost, but the gift of the Holy Ghost. And in Acts chapter 10, 45, "And they of the circumcision which believed were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because that on the Gentiles also was poured out," what? "The gift of the Holy Ghost," or the gift of the Holy Spirit. So we have this mention of a gift, or the gift specifically of the Holy Spirit. So these spiritual gifts are God-granted empowerments or endowments for the ministry on the part of the believers. And Paul speaks of spiritual gifts without mentioning even the word gifts at times. If, for instance, we could turn to 1 Timothy chapter 4. 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 14. He says, "Neglect not the gift that is in thee, which was given thee by prophecy with the laying on the hands of the presbytery." Did I say it was mentioned without the word gifts? It was mentioned without the word Spirit is what I meant. Let me just go back and say it again. That sometimes Paul speaks of spiritual gifts without mentioning the word Spirit. And as we see an example here in 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 14, he says, "Neglect not the gift that was in thee," but he mentions one of the gifts, and that gift is prophecy. And as we'll see, prophecy is certainly one of the gifts of the Spirit. In 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 6, 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 6, here Paul says, Wherefore I put thee in remembrance, that thou stir up the gift of God, which is in thee by the putting on of my hands. When he says stir up the gift, the Greek says it fan the flame. Fan the flame. Now, of course, the work of the Spirit was spoken of in the Old Testament. We know that there were certain gifts of the Spirit given in the Old Testament. Predominantly, we would probably quickly think of prophecy. For instance, who was the first prophet mentioned in the Bible? Who? Enoch. That's right, Enoch. The seventh from heaven prophesied of these things, saying, behold, the Lord cometh with 10,000 of his saints, and so on. Yes, Enoch was a prophet. First one that we know that was mentioned of as a prophet. We know Noah was a prophet. We know Moses was a prophet, many others. But let me just show you another example of something. If we turn to Exodus 31. Because remember, prophecy is not the only gift, or prophets, and we'll maybe show a distinction in that in just a second, or why there is said as such. Did I say Exodus 31?
Yes.
Yes, Exodus 31, and we'll read the first three verses. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, see, I have called by name Bezalel, the son of Uri, the son of Hur, of the tribe of Judah. And I have filled him with the Spirit of God in what?
Wisdom,
and in understanding and knowledge and all manner of workmanship. He had a special gift from the Spirit to be able to be a craftsman, to prepare these items for the sanctuary, to make them exactly as God wanted them, to make them beautiful and to properly represent what God had given them in the blueprint. We mentioned Enoch all the way to Malachi in the Old Testament prophets, and the Bible in the Old Testament prophesied of the Spirit to be poured out in the New Testament time and then on to the end. In Joel chapter 2, if we could turn to Joel chapter 2, verses 28 and 29. And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, that your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, your old men shall dream dreams, your young men shall see visions, and also upon the servants and upon the handmaids in those days will I pour out my Spirit. Many other places in the Gospels and Acts we see the work of the Spirit, and time limits us to focus upon the texts that speak more directly of the spiritual gifts or gifts of the Holy Spirit. And there are three main lists. The first one's found in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. And so if we could turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. I'll read verses 8 through 10, followed by verse 28. I'll read verse 7 also. It says, but the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit withal. For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit. Remember, Bezalel had both those, didn't he? To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, the gifts of healing by the same Spirit. To another, the working of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, discerning of spirits. To another, divers kinds of tongues. To another, the interpretation of tongues. Verse 28. And God has set in the church, first, apostles. Secondarily, prophets. Thirdly, teachers. After that, miracles. Then gifts of healing, helps, governments, diversities of tongues. In our next slide, we have these references with these different gifts laid out here so we can review them easily, again, quickly. But it says that you have the word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, you have faith. Oh, remember, the Bible says God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. And faith comes by hearing and hearing the word of God. Our faith can increase, can it? But apparently some people have a very special gift of faith to be able to believe and to trust in a way that does something that helps the rest of the church, not just themselves. Because remember, these gifts are given for the edification of the church. I mean, we really haven't established that yet, but we're going to. It speaks about the gifts of healing, and we'll talk about that in more detail later. But it is a plural. That's interesting. Gifts of healing. Miracles, because there are more than one kind of miracle. There's many different kinds of miracles. We'll look at that too in a little bit. Prophecy and prophets. Well, where you have a prophecy, you need a prophet. When you have a prophet, you get a prophecy. But there's a reason, I think, that we see both of these kind of usages of this expression in some of these verses we're going to be looking at. Discernment, the ability to judge or decide what's right or wrong or what's being done that's proper or not. Discernment. We know the gift of tongues, and that means we could also say languages. I think maybe I put that in another one. And of course, there's the interpretation of tongues. Apostles, he says teachers, helps or forms of assistance, governments, forms of leadership. All of these are very important. Now let's go to the next list, and that's in Romans chapter 12. The next list we're going to look at, Romans chapter 12. And we're going to read verses 6 through 8. Having then gifts, differing according to the grace that is given to us, whether prophecy, let us prophesy according to the proportion of faith, or ministry, let us wait on our ministering, or he that teacheth on teaching, verse 8, or he that exhorteth on exhortation, he that giveth, let him do it with simplicity, he that ruleth, with diligence, he that sheweth mercy with cheerfulness. And so here we have, in our next slide, we have here another list, and I've sort of written them out here. We have, again, prophecy is mentioned, ministry is mentioned, teaching is mentioned, exhortation. Exhortation means encouraging or appealing. In fact, I'm going to come back to this group in just a minute, but if I go to slide number 8, if you have the slides, you see here, this is the way, different ways that the word, the Greek word that's translated exhortation, is used in the New Testament. And you notice that in the top, that one of the main parts of this diagram ring is to comfort. Is to comfort, or to beseech, or to pray, or to beg. It means all of these different things. And I'm just going to give you some examples of how this word is used, because when we think of exhortation, we usually think of someone basically teaching or telling you how to do something, right? But that really isn't what this word means. I mean, not in our common vernacular. Maybe it meant that in the days of King James, but it has a little different meaning today. So let's turn to Acts chapter 20 and verse 12. Acts chapter 20, verse 12. Do you remember in Acts chapter 20, Paul was preaching, and he was preaching, you know, we might say, a long time. And there was a little young man by the name of Eutychus that was sitting up on top of the windowsill, and he fell out. And he was killed. And Paul went down and prayed, and he came back to life. And notice what it says about the situation, verse 12. And they brought the young man alive and were not a little comforted. And that word that we translate comfort is the same word we translate exhort or exhortation in Romans. So they were comforted by this. And as we said, it can mean comfort. In 1 Thessalonians 4:18, you know this text, I think, quite well. You may not remember by verse and chapter, but when we get there, you'll see. 1 Thessalonians 4:18. Paul is speaking about Jesus and his second coming, and we're not all asleep, but we're all going to be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trump shall sound, the dead in Christ shall rise first, and then we shall be, who are alive and remain, shall be caught up together with him to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. And then he says in verse 18, wherefore comfort one another with these words. But the word that we translate comfort is also translated exhort, or give exhortation. So that's what this word means. It means to give comfort, or even to beseech, or to beg, or to ask. For instance, Mark chapter 1, verse 40. It says, and there came a leper to him, to Jesus, beseeching him, and kneeling down to him, and saying unto him, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. But the word that we translate beseeching here is this same basic word that is translated exhort. And then in Matthew chapter 8, and verse 5. Remember the centurion? And when Jesus was entered into Capernaum, there came unto him a centurion beseeching him. He was asking, he was begging him, give me comfort, Lord, I need your help. So that's sort of what that expression, going back now to slide 7, of exhortation means. It means an appeal or encouraging. There's a gift of giving. You know, we've all met people that just, and I'm not speaking simply of monetary means, but although that's included, of course, but there are people that just have the gift to give. Everything they have, they just give it out to the Lord. There's ruleth. Now, he speaks ruleth here, but the word really means one who leads or gives aid. It doesn't mean someone who is the dictator. That's not the concept at all. And then he speaks about that there's a special gift of people who just have the ability to show mercy. To show mercy in ways that maybe others don't. Now, there's one more list, and it's in Ephesians 4, and it's pretty simple, and they're mostly all already covered, but not quite. Galatians, Ephesians 4:11. And he gave some apostles, and some prophets, and some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers. And I'm on slide 9, if you have the slides. And you notice here that I have apostles, prophets, evangelists, but then we have pastors and teachers together. Do you see that on the slide? And that's because that really is the way grammatically they are in the text. And it is even in the English, if you look at it carefully. Sometimes we put the and on the last of a list, but this and is designed to join these two together. Pastors and teachers, they're sort of like a package unit. Pastors have to be able to teach. In fact, we're really not preaching today at all, are we? This is a didactic message today. We're just teaching today. Not really trying to even have a sermon. We're just having class today. And these are callings that the Spirit puts upon people, gives a gift. God gives them a call to do these functions of His church. You know, not everyone's an apostle. In the days of Jesus, not everyone was an apostle. How many apostles did Jesus choose?
12.
No, He chose 11. One chose Him. Remember? Judas. Jesus chose 11. Judas chose Him. He wanted to be part of that group. And there are people today who do the same thing. They choose to be a pastor. They choose to be a prophet or an evangelist. But it's God who makes the choice. He makes those choices, you know. And He gives a calling. Someone asked Spurgeon one time, you know, how do they know that they're called? Or this one, in fact, one fellow said, he knew he was called to be a preacher. And Spurgeon said, how do you know that? He says, well, I felt it, everything else. And Spurgeon said, I don't think so. I don't think so. He says, generally, someone who's really called to preach will probably be successful at anything else they do. And everything else they do. He says, but they've been called to a specific thing. And this is a calling. And I would love to be able to take time and give you my testimony about how God called me, but we don't have time today. But the Bible teaches that every Christian receives at least one gift. Let's look at some of these verses again. 1 Corinthians 12, verse 7. It says, but the manifestation of the Spirit is given to only some men, or a few. It's given to every man to profit with all. And it's using the generic term for humanity here. Verse 11, but all these worketh that one and the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man severally as He will, to every person. Verse 18, but now hath God set the members, every one of them, in the body as it hath pleased Him. Chapter 14, verse 1, it says, follow after charity and desire spiritual gifts, but rather that ye may prophesy. In Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 7, he says, but unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. Every one of us. And 1 Peter 4:10. He says, unto every man hath received the gift, even so minister the same one to another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. So God has given to each one of us some gift, and it's to minister, and it's to help others. Now obviously, some, if not most people, receive more than one gift. I think it might be really hard if we would really look at the situation of anyone who's received spiritual gifts to find someone who only has one. Most people, I think, have more than one spiritual gift. In Ephesians, let's see. Let's go back to 1 Corinthians 14 first. 1 Corinthians 14, 13. He says, wherefore, let him that speaketh in an unknown tongue pray that he may interpret. Well, speaking in an unknown tongue was, or a tongue, the unknown is italicized there, as you notice, and we'll mention that again later. But speaking in language was a gift. But he says interpreting is also a gift. And he says, let him who speaks also interpret. And so that's two gifts in one. And in Ephesians 4:11, we saw that pastors and teachers go together. We noticed Beelzebul, he had at least three gifts of wisdom and knowledge and understanding that we saw earlier. Paul was an apostle. Did Paul teach? Paul pastored. Paul was a prophet. Paul had the gifts of healing at times. You know, I mean, we could look at many multitudes of situations. Paul says he spoke in tongues. He comforted the flock. I think it might be possible to argue that it'd be hard to find a gift that Paul didn't have, in fact. And he might be one of the very few people who may have had virtually almost all the gifts of the Spirit. He certainly was a man who could give. But not everyone has all of the gifts, and that's a fact for sure. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and we read in verse 28 about some more of those gifts just a few minutes ago. But now he says in verse 29, are all apostles? And what's the implied answer? No. Are all prophets? No. Are all teachers? No. Are all workers of miracles? No, not everyone works miracles. Have all the gifts of healing? No. Do all speak with tongues? No. Do all interpret? No. But covet earnestly the best gifts. And then he says, yet I show unto you a more perfect way. And then he goes into the love chapter in chapter 13 of Corinthians there. But friends, this is why. This is one of the important reasons why we need each other. No one person, at least usually, has been given all the spiritual gifts. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 12 through 26, Paul uses the body as an analogy to illustrate the need that we have for all of these spiritual gifts working together in the church at the same time. And you know, every part of your body isn't a finger, every part of your body isn't an eye, every part of your body doesn't have the ability to hear. You know, we're made up of all these different parts or components. And Paul brings out, he says, even the smallest ones are very important. You know, that which you think is the least, you might find out when you lose it, is pretty important. And this illustrates, have you ever heard the expression, unity in diversity? Mm-hmm. And sometimes, in the ecumenical movements, that's used to say that we have unity through all kinds of different stupid beliefs. But there is a unity in diversity, but it's in having a diversity of the gifts. Now, in slide number 10, we have here from Manuscript Releases, volume 21, page 276, paragraph 3, the following statement. Again, that's Manuscript Release, volume 21, page 276. The vine has many branches, but though all the branches are different, they do not coil. In diversity, there is unity. All the branches obtain their nourishment from one source. This is an illustration of the unity that is to exist among Christ's followers. In their different lines of work, they all have but one head. The same Spirit, in different ways, works through them. There is harmonious action though the gifts differ. Study this chapter, you will see from it that the man who is truly united with Christ will never act as though he were a complete whole in himself. End quote. Pretty good quote, isn't it? In other words, no one should think they can do everything, because that's just not the way God's made his church to be generally. This diversity should never be allowed to result in schisms or quarrels, because we are all gifted by the same Holy Spirit, who also indwells in us. In Romans chapter 8, verses 9 through 11, he says, but ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. But if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you. Friends, we should be controlled by that Spirit. And that Spirit's not going to tell one person to go contrary to the other person that's being led by the Spirit either. Isn't that right? And in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 again, it says in verse 4, now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are different gifts, but this Spirit, this one Spirit gives different gifts, and usually to different people. And it says, and there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. We've read this earlier, and there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which worketh all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit for all. On slide number 11, we have A statement from councils to parents, teachers, and students on page 314, paragraph 3. It says, God dispenses his gifts as it pleases him. Period. Did you get that? God dispenses his gifts as it pleases him. Oh, but Lord, you know, I wanted to prophesy. Or Lord, I want the gift of singing. Well, maybe God hasn't chosen to give me those gifts. That's not for me to decide. Did you get that?
Sure.
It's not for me to decide. God dispenses his gifts as it pleases him. He bestows one gift upon one and another gift upon another, but all for the good of the whole body. It is in God's order that some shall be of service in one line of work and others in other lines, all working under the selfsame spirit. The recognition of this plan will be a safeguard against emulation, pride, envy, or contempt of one another. It will strengthen unity and mutual love. This is God's program. This is God's program. In slide number 12, we have a statement from Christ Object Lessons. All men do not receive the same gifts, but to every servant of the Master, some gift of the Spirit is promised. Paul's experience shows us that likely some of the specific gifts actually encapsulate or overlap with several other gifts. For example, the gift of the apostle probably encapsulates the gift of teaching and leadership as well. But I want to consider just a little bit of some of these specific gifts for just a minute. And the gifts of miracles, the gifts of miracles. It shows that Christ is not restricted by what we consider the reality of the physical world, but rather is Lord over all creation. You know, you think about the miracles, the things like turning water into wine, walking on water. Our senses tell us that this is not possible. That there are physical laws of nature that just says this can't do that and we can't do that. But whenever we have these kind of miracles being performed, it shows that the Lord is over his creation and he is not restricted or bound by anything concerning it. We have the word of wisdom. We read about that in 1 Corinthians 12:8. And this has to do with the ability to speak a word of wise counsel in a difficult situation. And I think maybe many of us have seen this happen before. We've experienced it in church situations where someone just had the ability to understand the mind of the Spirit at just the right time to give the counsel and the wisdom that was necessary. We spoke about the gifts of healing. Remember, Paul spoke about the gifts of healing in the church. And this should be considered for a moment, because the New Testament actually has many accounts of healing, gifts of healing. And if we would turn to 2 Corinthians 12 and verse 12, he says here, truly the signs of an apostle were wrought among you in all patience, in signs and wonders and mighty deeds. That's 2 Corinthians 12:12. Let me read that again. Truly the signs of an apostle were wrought among you in all patience, in signs and wonders and mighty deeds. Now, the word that we translate signs is from a Greek word, semion. And this particular word is translated also miracles a great many times in the Bible. In fact, it's translated 22 times of the 77 times it's used, it's translated miracle or miracles. And for example, in Luke 23 and verse 8, I'm on slide number 13 now. In Luke 23 verse 8, it's translated miracles. John 2:1, the beginning of the miracles did Jesus in Canaan of Galilee when he turned the water into wine. So sometimes this word semion in the Greek is translated signs. Sometimes it's just translated miracles. But when it's translated as signs, it just means a miracle. Something, it's a sign, something you look at that's just, you know, doesn't fit the normal way things work. Now, though many were healed, as recorded in the New Testament, not everyone was healed that was sick. Let me give you an example. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 20. He says, Erastus abode in Corinth, but Trophimus have I left in Miletus sick. Well, Paul, you had the gift of healing. Why did you leave him sick? Because, friends, people who sometimes have a gift of healing don't always have a gift of healing. He left him sick. And furthermore, if we go to 1 Timothy chapter 5 and verse 23, we find that Timothy was sick. He has bad stomach. I don't know what it was, but some kind of stomach ailment. And it says, drink no longer water, but use a little wine for thy stomach's sake and thine often infirmities. He was basically saying, use this natural treatment. Get some grape juice and heal yourself. Isn't that interesting? But this was the Apostle Paul. You would think if anyone could have healed him in the New Testament, it would have been Paul. But God didn't choose to always heal everybody. Only when God willed was there a healing in such manners. So this plurality, this gifts of healing, it indicates that such a gift can be manifested in more ways than one. Miraculous healings may be of the form that someone is healed instantly. It comes sometimes, as it says in James 5, verses 13 through 16, through prayer and anointing. And sometimes it may just simply come through some kind of a natural treatment. You remember when Hezekiah was sick? And the Bible says he was sick unto death. But Isaiah said, no, you go make a poultice of figs and put it upon the boil and he'll live. But he was healed, wasn't he? And we think God did this, but he used a natural treatment to help it. So those are just different ways that healing can work. Yet despite the gift of healings, you know what, friends? Everyone dies. No one just keeps living and living and living. Everyone dies. As believers, we wait for the full and the final redemption of our bodies. And certainly these gifts point to the fact that God will ultimately bring the complete healing of the body and the mind when necessary, when Jesus comes. The Bible speaks about this. The Bible speaks about that there will be a time when this mortal will put on immortality, this corruptible will put on incorruption. The fact that Paul did not heal all the time brings us to an important consideration. And that is that certain spiritual gifts should be understood primarily as events or activities or functions in the church, and that these gifts are only secondarily as abilities or empowerments in the church. For instance, you have people who prophesy and then you have prophets. You have people who teach and you have teachers. You have that function, that empowerment, and then you have that activity that follows with it. I should maybe mention quickly the gift of tongues or the gift of languages in Acts chapter 2. I'll read verses 1 through 8. It says, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as fire, and it set upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men, out of every nation under heaven. And when this was noised abroad, the multitude came together and were confounded, because that every man heard them speak in something they couldn't understand at all. Said they heard in their own language. And they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, behold, are not all these which speak Galileans? Verse 8, and how hear we every man in our own tongue wherein we were born? And so they were speaking languages, friends. These were people from Galilee, but yet it goes on to list all the different people who were there from different parts of the world, and they had different languages that they spoke. But yet they were all hearing these people speak in their own languages. In every place in the Bible that you read about what's called an unknown tongue, in every place that word unknown is italicized. It's a supplied word. Ellen White made a statement about this, and it's almost like she was, well, you just read it with me. Some of these persons have exercises which they call gifts and say that the Lord has placed them in the church. They have an unmeaning gibberish which they call the unknown tongue, which is unknown not only to man, but by the Lord of and all heaven. I thought that was pretty interesting. It's unknown, yeah, even to the Lord. He doesn't understand it. Such gifts are manufactured by men and women, aided by the great deceiver. Aided by the great deceiver. Fanaticism, false excitement, false talking in tongues, and noisy exercises have been considered gifts which God has placed in the church. Some have been deceived here. the fruits of all this have not been good. You shall know them by their fruits. In fact, I read about a situation that happened. A man went into a Pentecostal church, and they thought they were speaking in tongues, but they were cursing God in French, and the man happened to know what the French language was. And they were cursing God in French, thinking they were praising God. This statement continues. It's one long paragraph. This is the rest of it. I'm on slide number 15. Fanaticism and noise have been considered special evidences of faith. Some are not satisfied with a meeting unless they have a powerful and happy time. They work for this and get up an excitement of feeling, but the influence of such meetings is not beneficial. When the happy flight of feeling is gone, they sink lower than before the meeting because their happiness did not come from the right source. The most profitable meetings for spiritual advancement are those which are characterized with solemnity and deep searching of heart, each seeking to know himself and earnestly and in deep humility seeking to learn of Christ. Now, I said that today we would try to speak especially about prophecy, and I'm going to delay that until next week, but just remember this. Prophecy is an important gift. Paul says that we should desire the best gifts in 1 Corinthians 12:31, and then he goes on to speak about charity or love, but then in 1 Corinthians 14 and verse 1, we can go ahead and read it. We read it earlier, I believe, but we'll read it again. 1 Corinthians 14:1, he says, follow after charity. Desire spiritual gifts, but rather that you may prophesy. So it's an important gift. And all the gifts are important. As we know, the Apostle Paul, he makes this analogy about the body. In chapter 12 of 1 Corinthians, and verse 23, he says, and those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, upon these we bestow more abundant honor, and our uncomely parts have more abundant comeliness. You know, there are people who think, oh, you know, I want to be the prophet. I want to be the apostle. I want to be the evangelist. I want to be the pastor. Let me tell you something. People who want to be pastors probably don't know anything about it, most generally. However, Spurgeon also said this. He says, you take a man who is a pastor. If he can be comfortable and happy doing anything else in the world, he shouldn't be a pastor. Because he must have a zeal. He must have that desire. It must be in his bones burning that this is the only thing that he can do because God has called him to it, friends. And that's true. So all of these gifts are important, though, friends. We need them all. And God doesn't count one himself as making a person better than anyone else because they have that particular gift. No church can function if everyone only wanted to have the role of the pastor or the teacher or the evangelist. I want to watch your reaction. These are charismatic gifts. Because that's where the word comes from. Charismatic comes from charisma. These are the gifts of the Spirit. And they're important. Just like prophecy is important. Just like miracles are important. Now, we've read through three different lists. Do you remember where those first three lists were? Where were they found at? 1 Corinthians 12, Romans where? Oh, do we have notes?
Was it 8? 9 and 11.
Chapter 8, verses 9 through 11? Are you sure?
Romans 12. 6 through 8.
Romans 12, 6 through 8. And then the third list was found in Ephesians chapter 4. Okay, very good. Yes, 4:11 specifically, that's right. So I ask a question, are these the only gifts? Well, I think it's safe to say that the gifts given in the early church were in principle representative gifts in the church that cover a broad range of needs for the people of God. Now, since people fundamentally and functionally are the same in all ages, what was needful for the early church is probably most likely needful for the church in all ages. But then we have to ask the question, well, do we really have every gift that was listed? Or do some of these gifts have different ways of working? For instance, Paul said that there's this gift of giving comfort. How do you do that? Maybe it's you bringing someone a loaf of bread, and God gives you the ability to make that loaf of bread so that you can comfort. Brother Bob, yes?
There must be one nowadays in understanding electronic equipment.
There must be one in understanding electronic equipment. Well, you know what? That's why we always look for someone young to do to do that stuff. But think about this. What about music? Can music be a comfort to people?
Yes.
If it's done right, it can just be a wonderful comfort. In fact, Ellen White says this. Let me go on here. This is from Testimonies for the Church, Volume 9, page 144, slide 16. In our efforts in behalf of the multitudes dwelling in cities, we must try to do thorough service. The work in a large center of population is greater than one man can successfully handle. God has different ways of working. He has different workmen to whom he entrusts varied gifts. And then she says, one worker may be a ready speaker. Another, a ready writer. Another may have the gift of sincere, earnest, fervent, what?
Prayer.
Paul didn't mention prayer as one of the gifts, did he? But here she says that it's one of the gifts. Another, the gift of what?
Singing.
Singing. I've had so many people say to me, Brother Alan, you don't have the gift of singing. But I would say this. It may not be a specially anointed gift, but friends, many talents that we've been entrusted with, if we will try to improve them, and we are to try to improve them, it's amazing what God can do to bless. Another may have special power to explain the Word of God with clearness. And each gift is to become a power for God because He works with the laborer. To one, God gives the word of wisdom, to another, knowledge, to another, faith, but all are to work under the same head, capital H head. The diversity of gifts leads to a diversity of operations, but it is the same God which worketh all in all, 1 Corinthians 12:6. And again, that's taken from Testimonies for the Church, Volume 9, pages 144 and 145. One question people sometimes wonder, and probably shouldn't be a question to us, but will these gifts continue until the end of time? And I think that we can see, yes, that they clearly do. If we would turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 6 through 8. Even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you, that ye come behind in no gift, waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall also confirm you unto the end, that ye may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. So God says these gifts are going to endure until the end, until Jesus comes. Because, friends, the church is going to need perfecting till then. Church isn't ready yet, but he's trying to get it ready. In Ephesians 4, again in verse 11, he gave these different gifts, the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, pastors, and teachers. Why? Verse 13 or 12, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God into a perfect man, into the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Are you still here? Are you still here?
I'm here.
I'm here too. I haven't been translated yet. Have you? No. We still need these gifts. We still need these helps because we haven't reached perfection yet, friends. But God's working toward that end in each of our lives. There's no biblical support which teaches that spiritual gifts were to be subordinated to or overtaken by institutionalized offices in the church. You know, there's this great big thing called Jezebel. And it likes to teach people that most of these gifts are not necessary anymore because they've been institutionalized in the church. But they will continue unto the end. You can also read that in 1 Corinthians 13, 8 through 12. But again, the purpose of these gifts is to build up the church. It's for the building up of the church. It's for the edifying of the body of Christ, to equip it for ministry. These are to be used, friends, without exception, in the service of one another for the benefit of all. These gifts are not given for self edification or glorification. They're not given just for you. They're given for the church. They are something that you are entrusted with as a steward, and you're to be a good steward. These gifts are never to be used for our own profit or how we can be benefited by them. As it says in one translation of 1 Corinthians 12, 7, they are given to produce what is beneficial for the us, for the rest. Gifts are for ministry. And since we all get gifts, or gifts, then we're all expected to minister in some way or another. We're all expected to be workers for Christ. All Christians, friends, then have duties to execute in service for the Master, every one of us. In our web conference, we have this web conference thing that we're doing right now. And in our control panel, we have what we call a moderator. We have participants. And we can even log someone in as an observer. They just watch. They can't interact in any way. But friends, no one was ever meant to be, merely be a receiver of a ministry or a blessing and just be an observer. All of God's people are both to give and to receive ministry, every one of us. And if you think, well, you know, I couldn't have any gift, Brother Allen. God couldn't do anything for me. Well, friends, I'm sorry. Your word's not good enough for me, because God's word is greater. And if God says, I've given to everyone something, that means he's given to everyone something. Now, friends, if you're not part of the church, if you're out in disobedience, if you're not going to obey the Holy Spirit, then no, you're not going to get gifts. But if you are a sincere Christian, you have something. I can't necessarily tell you what it is. Sometimes the church recognizes it among people. You know, there's a gift that we haven't mentioned that I think is a gift, and it's called the gift of hospitality. And I think Sister Ann certainly has that gift. She is like the most hospitable person. I mean, you know, she can't do enough to try to make you feel at home when you're there. But friends, as a church, we will not, locally or globally, achieve the level of maturity that Christ needs for us to have before he can come until all of our members are actively demonstrating their giftness by engaging in ministry and using the talents and the gifts that God has given us. Sometimes, you know, we call upon someone to do something and say, oh, I don't want to do that. I don't want to get up front. Friends, if God has given us a gift, we have to use it. Did you get it? If God has given us a gift, we have to use it. We have to be faithful to him. We have to be good stewards. And when the church discovers the importance of an every member ministry, then we will truly experience the growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. Now, next week, we're going to be talking about prophecy. And you don't want to miss that. It's going to be really interesting. It's going to be another didactic kind of lesson. And I think you'll be benefited by it. I really do.